Welcome to Oath Keepers Now. I'm Mike Chisholm. I'll be your host today. Oath Keepers is a nonpartisan organization. We consist of active duty and retired military, law enforcement, firemen, EMTs, basically anyone that swore the oath to the Constitution or wished to swear the oath to the Constitution. Today I have some very special guests from the John Birch Society. With me I have Bliss 2.
How are you, Mike?
Thank you for showing up today. And I have Dale.
Dale Pierce.
First of all, could you tell me a little bit about yourself, please, sir?
Sure. Bliss 2, kind of a hard name to remember, Bliss, like ignorance is bliss. I'm a Western Regional Field Director for the John Birch Society for 11 Western states. That's a paid field staff position. Field coordinators like Dale Pierce work with me over territories within the region. They help work with and supervise the volunteer section leaders, chapter leaders, committee chairmen in our volunteer organization in their region or in their territory. I've been with the John Birch Society as a volunteer member first since about 20 years ago, and now I've been on the staff for 13 years in the field. So that tells you a little bit about me. I live in Utah, so I'm up here working with Dale. We gave a presentation last night in Twin Falls, and now we're over here in Pocatello, and we've got some other calls to make.
So you travel a lot, don't you?
Yeah, last week I was in Orange County working, and the week before that up in Spokane, Washington, and the week before that, San Francisco, San Jose area. So I travel a lot.
Wow. How about you, Dale?
I've been on the staff for 22 years of the John Birch Society. I try to meet everybody in all the towns around the great state of Idaho. And that's both the first congressional district and the second congressional district.
Question, but now that I have you on, how long has the John Birch Society been in existence?
Well, we've been in existence for 53 years. We were formed December 8th and 9th, 1958, and formed by a wonderful gentleman by the name of Robert Welch. He was a candy manufacturer back in Massachusetts. We've been over five decades now preaching a message of educating the electorate as a way of solving the problems in America. If we know the truth can keep us free. If we don't know the truth, we can be deceived into bondage. So that's how old we are, and we can tell you a lot more about us. I don't know how much time you want to take up on that, but we'd be glad to tell you all about us.
Well, we've got some time today. So, what would you say, Dale?
Well, you know, we're more into issues. We like to teach people the correct principles of good constitutional government. And we believe that our rights don't come from government. That's probably, that's probably different than what our children are being taught in public education. But we believe what the Constitution says, that men are endowed by their Creator with life, liberty, and property, pursuit of happiness. And probably nowadays that we send our children into public education, most of them come out with no concept of our constitutional government. So when they come out, they have big questions, and they think that government is the answer.
So you think our school systems are not doing what they really should do, and that is educate our children about the Constitution and how the United States of America was formed, basically?
I think you're right. I think public education is simply one thing. It's government education.
And wouldn't you also say a lot of it would come also from us, the parents, talking to our children, making sure our children understand, or asking them, what did you learn today in school? Did you learn anything about Thomas Jefferson or George Washington? That'd be some interesting questions.
Well, they probably learned that Thomas Jefferson had slaves like the Hemings girl that they say that he probably fathered children with, or George Washington, what a rascal he was. He was a slave owner. Instead of being the father of the Constitution, they probably put our founding fathers up for great ridicule. We don't like that. Of course, type of education nobody wants their children or grandchildren to receive, but that's happening.
But no one's perfect. I mean, who is perfect?
And I think it depends a lot, too, on the educator. You know, we're talking about millions of individuals that are educators across this country. There's plenty of educators who want to teach the truth, who want to give a good impression of America. But what we're saying is, you know, when you have government in control of education, then government has a self-interest. Of course, I don't think that's the whole topic we want to talk about today is the education arena, but you're right. Parents have a duty to educate their children, and parents should have an impact on their children, and we should also hold up the culture of America and our Declaration of Independence and our Constitution and our history to our children to help them understand both the good and the bad about our country. It's not that our country as an entity has never done anything wrong. Everyone makes mistakes, and there are men and women within government that have evil intentions. But the system that was designed by our founders was a system that had every good intention in it for protecting the individual and the rights, the God-given rights of life, liberty, property, and pursuit of happiness, and those rights that are contained in the Bill of Rights and others. The idea was to protect the individual. That was the role of government. The proper role of government is put forth in the Declaration of Independence. All men are created equal and endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights, and among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And so governments are instituted by men for the purpose of protecting those rights.
Well, that's going to bring me up to a later question about the National Defense Authorization Act.
Sure.
But before I get there, how big is your organization? How many members? Are you state, national? I know you're nationally. Sorry about that, guys. You know.
No, we are national. Mike, our actual numbers have always been private the whole time we've existed. And we also keep our members' membership private. We don't sell lists of our members to advertisers or anybody like that, or to political parties. We're a nonpartisan organization. We don't endorse candidates. It doesn't mean that we don't speak about candidates or that we don't look at their records and report on their records and that kind of thing. But when you ask me our size, I can tell you, yes, we are a national organization. We're organized into local chapters. You might go to a given city, and find one chapter, or another city might have 10 or 15 chapters. We have hundreds and hundreds of chapters dotted across the country from coast to coast in every state. Those chapters are run by volunteer chapter leaders. They report to volunteer section leaders who have two to five chapters. And they report to area coordinators like Dale Pierce. They report to regional field directors like myself, and I report to our national director of field activities, Jim Fitzgerald, who's headquartered out in New Jersey. Our organization itself is headquartered in Appleton, Wisconsin. We're organized and created as a corporate entity in Massachusetts back in 58. So we have a board of incorporators, and we have a JBS council that's an advisory board. And we have a president and a CEO. Art Thompson is our CEO. John F. McManus is our president. We're very open. You know, we talk on radio, television, open meetings. We publish books. We publish a magazine that comes out 24 times a year, The New American.
I've read that. It's a really good magazine. It's right. A really good, where am I? It's a really good magazine.
Well, and Mike, we also have a website for this. It's www.thenewamerican.com.
Okay.
We have a website for the John Birch Society if people want to read up on us more, www.jbs.org. So anybody that wants to contact us or look into us, you can go right to that website, find our leaders, and find us.
Well, let's get into some of the meat and potatoes of this. The National Defense Authorization Act. I was going to ask you, what do you think some of the most critical issues that we have at hand presently for our fellow townsmen, our fellow Idahoans, our fellow countrymen? What do you feel is the most critical? And also, a follow-up, what's your position on the National Defense Authorization Act, especially Sections 1021?
Yeah. Well, you know, there's an awful lot of issues that are facing us. And one of the things I loved about the John Birch Society when I first came into contact with them is that we are a multi-issue organization. We're not a single-issue organization. And so we do look at all the issues. our motto really spells out what our mission is: less government, more responsibility, and with God's help, a better world. Now, that doesn't mean no government. We're not anarchists. We believe in limited government. We particularly want to see the government that was formed under our Constitution, a constitutional republic, federated states that have come together to form a constitutionally limited republic. So,
I apologize for interrupting. You know, I hear a lot of people all the time, and this is political individuals in high offices, they say we live in a democracy. We don't. We live in a republic, and that comes from education, and this is why.
Yeah, you know, Mike, Benjamin Franklin, I'll just paraphrase him. I'm not going to try and quote him directly, but he gave us a little idea of what's the difference between the two. And he said that a democracy is two wolves and a lamb voting on what's for lunch, okay, because it's majority rule. And the John Birch Society, like the Founding Fathers, has shunned the idea of direct democracy. It doesn't mean that there isn't individual choice and democratic voting on many, many things, such as voting in a congressman for the House of Representatives. Certainly there's democratic representation there. We recognize that each individual needs to be represented in government. But what we do look at as a republic is the rule of law. Our law, the Constitution, is the supreme law of the land. Over the Supreme Court, every single elected and appointed official in the federal government, including our soldiers, take an oath of office. And the president takes an oath of office. He puts his hand on the Bible. He takes an oath of office, and he says he swears to protect and preserve and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, both foreign and domestic. So the president's, one of his chief roles is to protect, preserve, and defend the Constitution of the United States. Not violate it, not try and usurp powers that aren't delegated to him under the Constitution. For example, you brought up NDAA, the National Defense Authorization Act.
Yes.
Section 1021 in particular you brought up. And for anybody listening that really hasn't heard about this yet, Section 1021 has a very onerous provision that allows military authorities to arrest within our country even American citizens and hold them without habeas corpus or without trial or without a hearing or without even contact with an attorney. The John Birch Society has put out several articles about this, both on our website and in writing, to try and promote the idea that that Section 1021 needs to be repealed. We're glad to see that Congressman Ron Paul, Congressman Rand Paul, and others have come out against that 1021 section that's talking about giving the power to the military to arrest and indefinitely detain Americans without habeas corpus. This is positively un-American. It moves towards allowing the executive authority a tyrannical ability to arrest Americans through military. And it's against the
Posse
Comitatus Act of 1876.
Yes, it does.
So it's a violation of law, previous law. It's certainly a violation of the Constitution's provisions for habeas corpus. It's a violation of our belief as Americans that all men are innocent until proven guilty. Where are they proven guilty? In a court of law. That means you have to charge them with the crime, you have to hold hearings for them, allow them habeas corpus, allow them an attorney, and allow them a hearing and a trial before their guilt is decided and they're imprisoned. So this idea of imprisoning first and asking questions later is a complete about face on the American system.
So this NDAA, National Defense Authorization Act, which was Senate Bill 1867, is totally unconstitutional. And I'd like to say you didn't finish that quote, which I think is a great quote about two wolves and a lamb deciding what to have. Well, let me tell you, it's two wolves and a lamb deciding what to have for dinner or lunch. A well-armed lamb contesting the vote.
That's a republic.
That's a republic.
Yeah, a well-armed lamb contesting the vote.
But how badly has this NDAA, from what I understand, it has done away with the Bill of Rights, pretty much, has done away with the majority of our constitutional rights. Would you agree or disagree?
It hasn't been implemented yet, so we haven't seen it in action. But certainly if a man or a woman that's a citizen of the United States can be arrested somewhere within the confines of the United States by military forces of the United States and held indefinitely without being able to counsel with an attorney, without being able to have a habeas corpus hearing to determine whether or not there's cause for them to be under arrest, and if they can be imprisoned indefinitely, that completely abolishes our rights under the Fourth Amendment and the Fifth Amendment, and so many areas of our rights, even, you know, that it does turn things up on
end. Yeah, it's one of the reasons our founding fathers did not want a standing army. The only thing standing they wanted was a navy, because they knew that they had to control the seas and they had to be ready immediately to defend our borders. But not a standing army, not within the we had a standing army under King George III, and his redcoats were here. And they were a standing army, and we knew that we didn't want that.
But that's what the National Guard is for. The National Guard, for every state, that's what it was designed for.
Well, Mike, originally it was state guards.
Oh, they called
state
them
militias. Okay. In 1903, there was an act passed that supposedly consolidated state militias under National Guard. But the National Guard is an arm of the standing army of the United States. They get their paychecks from the U.S. Army instead of state guard. Now, some states have still continued to keep state guard. Very few, four or five. I'd like personally, at least, to see us move back to there's unorganized militia. The organized militia was the state guard.
You say militia, and mm-hmm. and there's a lot of people, there's a lot of misconceptions about Oath Keepers. And it's my show, so I can talk about Oath Keepers, sorry.
It's all right.
But the bottom line is, we've been tagged as a militia, and we're not. You know, we're out there just like the John Birch Society, trying to spread the word to as many people as we can that, hey, all these unconstitutional acts are being put into play, these laws, similar to the Weimar Republic.
Well, Mike, every man, woman, and child are technically members of the militia in the United States under federal law. So we're all actually members of the militia, the unorganized militia.
Okay.
When the state governments organized militia, then they were called state guard militia formations. The governor or the legislatures of the states appointed the officers of those militias. When we fought the war between the states, those militias were called into active duty, both in the North and the South. Then they became part of the standing army of the United States as active duty militia.
So it slowly morphed. So it morphed into.
It was, I think, an intentional morphing of state guards into National Guard, which is no longer. Look at the difference. In the Constitution, it says that the militia can be called up for three purposes: to enforce the law of the land, the Constitution, mm-hmm. to repel invasions, and to put down insurrections. That's all. It does not say that they shall go abroad to prosecute foreign wars or to build an empire for the New World Order or anything like that. The National Guard is constantly being called up and moved abroad to fight in Iraq or Somalia or Bosnia or Haiti or
Libya
or any number of places.
Usually under the title of UN
United
peacekeepers.
Nations peacekeeping or NATO
Speaking
police
of
actions.
UN, I'm glad you brought up UN.
Okay.
Project 60. Now, Project 60 is a big thing for me and many other Idahoans here that know what Project 60 is supposedly about. Can you give us, Dale or Bliss, some insight into Project 60 and how it coincides with Agenda 21, which is the UN agenda?
I'll cover Project 60 and Bliss can cover the Agenda 21.
Okay.
The state of Idaho has had for some time a desire to raise our gross national product from $50 billion a year up to $60 billion a year. That's quite an increase. But the idea that has come down through our state executive branch is that we'd like to do it with the help of the Red Chinese. And okay. Here in this city, in the city of Pocatello, you have actually seen that happen, where you have quite an investment here.
Are you speaking of like Hoku?
I was going to mention it, yeah.
Well, hey, everybody knows about Hoku. It's not a secret.
No, it's not a secret. And the Red Chinese are poised to come in and expend a lot more investment capital here in the state. We don't think that's a good idea. In fact, I was speaking with several legislators from Idaho, and they say, you know, Dale, we don't have any opportunity to stop that in any way. They can come in here. They can use private money. But they would like to know when state money or when national money comes in from a foreign power, especially hostile to the United States. So there will probably be some effort to put through a bill this session in our state legislature to at least notify our state legislators that more investment dollars from foreign nations are coming in here. There's a couple of things that really hit these legislators hard. One is the mining claims.
You're talking about the silver mines.
The silver and gold.
Yes.
There's a lot of interest there by the Red Chinese.
To
And then there's something called rare earth elements. And Bliss will have to say the name, but I think it's called
molybdenum.
Molybdenum.
Well, that's a hard one to say.
Well, see, I went through public education. I just have a hard time with things like that.
Well, I had penguin nuns, and I say that respectfully.
The idea is the Red Chinese evidently control about 90% of the rare earth minerals at
this
time.
Here in Idaho?
No, throughout the world.
In the world.
In the world.
Yeah.
What percentage in Idaho here?
Well, I don't know a percentage on that, but Idaho does have the rare earth mineral of molybdenum.
You can find that in Utah and Colorado, too.
And it's absolutely essential for building our high-tech steels and so forth, especially in combat fighters and so forth, interceptor fighters. So we don't want to give up that mineral in this state. Whether or not we can hold it dear, we have no idea, but we would like to see the governor involved in that issue and fight too, and not as a rollover, but as, hey, this is our properties, we're not going to give them up.
Well, I think there's another aspect we ought to mention on this too. You know, I look at Red China as my friend just called it, the People's Republic of China. It is completely under the authority of the Chinese Communist Party and the Politburo, so it is a Chinese communist-controlled government. It isn't a free government like the Constitutional Republic of the United States. We have to recognize that Chinese communism is simply part of international communism. International communism has not gone away, and its goal has always been very different than the goal of the American people. The goal is global dominance.
Your mic, don't mind us, that's okay. It happens on TV.
Okay. Global domination has been the goal always of the Communist Party and the Communist International. But I wanted to say this, you have to keep in mind that a lot of these big corporate entities that come out of China are what you call state-owned enterprises, SOEs. That means that they're wholly owned by the state of the People's Republic of China, which is completely controlled by the Politburo of the Chinese Communist Party. So you have to recognize that this isn't a regular corporate entity like in America that is formed by stockholders of the American people in a private enterprise situation. This is a wholly owned subsidiary of the People's Republic of China and the Communist Party, and therefore it has a lot of operative abilities to operate for the People's Liberation Army and so on. So espionage and other issues come into play when you talk about allowing state-owned enterprises on our soil and to own companies and own parts of companies.
And the land.
Own our land. The Idaho Statesman called that having a beachhead. Well, a beachhead is a military
terminology, yes.
Terminology for having position in a foreign country that you're invading. You gain a beachhead as your first objective, right? Like at Iwo Jima.
That's right. That's correct.
Let me name one of those companies. China National Machinery Industry Corporation, Sinomac. Okay, that was established in 1997. That is an enormous company, but it is a completely state-owned asset of the People's Republic of China.
Nationwide, I believe, right now.
Yeah, it's huge. It's just like the press in China. They own and control the press. For instance, China Daily newspaper is their biggest newspaper, and it's completely controlled by the Chinese Communist Party. They have a China Daily newspaper edition here in America that is published out of Washington, D.C. They were there at the
In Utah, in July.
There was a really big get-together, and they were welcomed with open arms, from what I understand.
The U.S. National Governors Association was having a meeting at the Grand America Hotel for American governors of the 50 states. I think about 30 showed up in Salt Lake City, June the 14th last year, 2011. And across the street at the Little America Hotel, these two hotels are beautiful, wonderful hotels owned by the same corporation. I love them. Beautiful places for
events. I've stayed at the Little America.
Okay. Well, across the street there at Little America, the Chinese governors were having their own forum. Very convenient that the two were right there. And that way they had joint forums together. So that
Chinese
they could talk
governors
about
with American
with
governors,
American governors.
By American governors.
That's right. So the idea was, how do we do more business with China here in America? This was all kind of done under the auspices, too, of the U.S. State Department. Hillary Clinton was particularly invested in bringing this about. And so we sent a reporter from the New American Magazine, William F. Jasper. And William Jasper, who lives here in Idaho, a native Idahoan, he wrote this article back in May of 2011 about China. It's right here. China, the new investment savior. And this article...
What's the fortune cookie say?
Oh, the fortune cookie says, you will be extremely successful in business.
That's good.
Anyway, the Chinese, of course, like I say, have been investing here. They have their sovereign wealth fund with close to $1 trillion of American Federal Reserve notes or treasury bills in it, and they're looking for investment. Where do they put that?
Are they selling this to not only the Utahans, but the Idahoans?
Oh, yeah, this is
national. Are they selling this as hey, this is to help
they're looking
and,
at this
and move
as
America
an,
forward, a prosperous thing?
Sure, they're going to bring jobs
economic
here. They're going to bring jobs here.
Well, that didn't happen in Hoku yet that I know of, so okay. I may be talking out of line here, but came to a complete stop from what I understand at this point. Yeah.
Well, and they may, who knows, maybe they'll even bring in their own workers. But the point down there was that this was kind of a way of getting a commingling between the Chinese governors and the American governors. And there was a lot of signing of, you know, friendship agreements and all that kind of stuff. To me, it smacked of a little bit of the governors usurping powers from the president and the State Department and the U.S. Senate, which are those powers of treaty making. When you start having meetings and making agreements, you're outside of your oath of office as a governor to be meeting with these foreign powers and setting up agreements. But that's just me. I'm just saying that. Article 1, Section 10 prohibits state governors and so on from making treaties with foreign powers. And you can call it by another name if you want, but that's the problem. But I wanted to finish telling you a little bit about
Sure.
Bill Jasper. When William Jasper wrote this article, it kind of ticked off some people at the National Governors Association, the U.S. National Governors Association. So when he tried to get press credentials to attend the National Governors Association, they wouldn't give him press credentials.
And why would that be?
Well, he went up through their different ranks until he finally got to the top one, and she said that he wasn't objective. And
that's pretty
and he says,
broad.
Now, wait a minute. You know, he's been attending UN functions all over the world for the past 30 years. He's been writing. He belongs to all the different press associations. He's written thousands of articles that have been published and published two books. He's a well-known author and investigative reporter, but they don't see him as objective. Well, who is exactly objective? Is CNN? Is Fox? Is Time? Is Newsweek? Are they objective? Is the Drudge Report objective? Everyone's got a point of view. But the really big clinker to all this was the following day, and we continued to work on reporting and covering these meetings, but the big thing came out the next day as William F. Jasper and Sam Antonio for Liberty News Network, one of our subsidiaries.
Yes, is that the one that's online?
Uh-huh.
Yes, I've heard of that.
They were there covering a meeting that was taking place at the University of Utah Rice-Eccles Stadium, okay? And this was Chinese governors together with American governors were having a big function there. Well, as people were coming out, Bill Jasper was interviewing them on camera, and a woman came out that Bill walked over to and said, do you work for one of the Chinese press organizations? She says, yes, I'm Lai Jing. I'm the, I don't know if I pronounce her name exactly correct, but Lai Jing, she was the
American editor.
American editor for China Daily.
Out of New York.
And she was also a top editor for the China Daily back in China. So this was a very high-level person. He said, she's got a press pass hanging right on her. He says, do you have a press pass to go to the National Governors Association? Well, yes. Well, he asked her, well, are there other, you can see this on YouTube, Mike.
Okay, yeah.
Are there other press members from China that are there with a press pass? Oh, yes, we have 15 people. We have people from different press organizations, China TV and China
different
Daily.
Different countries,
and
too.
From different provinces of China, they're here. So, in other words,
an investigative reporter
for the New American Magazine is an objective, but reporters from the China Daily, a completely communist-owned publication that has to kowtow to the Politburo and make communism look good worldwide, they're objective.
Well,
and they can have press passes.
Well, anyone with a brain would know that that's not correct.
Exactly.
But some would say that the communist move that in the direction that not only China, some people says Russia's moving back towards that position, and other countries, is the so-called quote-unquote New World Order. What's your take on that?
You know, if you got into the book, I think it came out 10, 15 years ago, I can't tell you. It was New Lies for Old by
Golitsyn.
Anatoly Golitsyn. He was a former Soviet KGB officer that had defected to the West. And decades in advance of things that happened, he gave projections of what you could expect to see happen. One of the things he projected was that the Berlin Wall would come down, and certainly it did. That was a window dressing to tell the people of the West that communism is dead. But communism is not dead. I mean, all we have to do is look at Red China, where 1 billion people are still under the control of the Communist Politburo there. Look at Vietnam, look at North Korea, look at Cuba. Communism is not dead. It's more dangerous than ever because it's assumed to be dead, and the Western press is telling us it's dead. And the Western media, I think, gets a lot of things wrong. But do you think a lot of things that are wrong,
do you believe they're doing it purposely, misinformation to the American people?
As opposed to accident or by design?
That's correct.
Okay.
Yes, we do.
We don't believe in many accidents.
We
do believe in design.
We think that, like President Franklin Roosevelt said, if something happens in government, it happens because it was planned to happen. We think that, let's go on and talk a little bit about the UN and about the Soviet Union.
Tell him the clincher on Lai Jing.
Oh.
Yeah, Lai Jing.
Well, okay. After Bill Jasper.
This is the reporter,
yeah,
yes.
After William F. Jasper from the New American and Sam Antonio from Liberty News Network, after they put out a